Welcome to Sparner Lemma. Today we are going to do purely combinatorial result and one single result. Okay, as a result in topology, but a combinatorial result, it has a very distinctive role. It's a landmark result which opened the floodgates for many other combinatorial results inside topology and vice versa. It is very simple to state. It is stated for the simplicial complex, namely the standard N simplex. Okay, so that way it is very simplest object as such. What you have to do is take any subdivision of the standard simplicial complex, the cell, n-dimensional simplex, delta n, okay? And take a simplicial approximation from delta n prime to delta n. One more condition you have to assume on this simplicial approximation phi is just a simplicial map. It is a simplicial approximation restricted to the boundary complex delta n prime. The boundary of delta n, remember, is topologically Sn minus 1. On that, Sn minus 1 to Sn minus 1, you have the identity map. That's a continuous function. So that function is simplicially approximated by phi on the boundary. Inside the simplex, it could be any simplicial map. Okay. Then the number of n simplices of delta n prime of the subdivision, which are mapped onto the entire of delta n, this number is odd. In particular, there is at least one, you see. There will not be two. There will be at least three then. If there are two, then there are already three. This number is odd. That is the meaning of this. In particular, there is at least one, and that is very important. Instead of proving that it is at least one, we are going to prove it's odd. So what is the meaning of that? We are only counting everything mod 2 and then show that it is 1. So even the counting is done mod 2. We are not bothered about 3500 and so on. No, don't get it. Just mod 2. Go on. So this is what we are going to do. The proof is what in combinatorial method, what one does by counting in different ways, two different ways, maybe three different ways, and so on. So I am going to state another version of the same lemma, Sparner lemma, which I am going to define, and that will be much more elaborate, and that will give the proof of this lemma once you prove that. So that is the idea of the proof. Okay. So here is a expanded version of the same lemma. So delta n prime is subdivision of delta n, and phi is a simplicial map. That is same thing. Now, L I am denoting the original delta n minus 1, the boundary, instead of writing every time boundary and so on. Without any subdivision, okay? So L is the boundary of, L is one of the simplexes, namely delta n minus 1. The last vertex is Chekhov. Okay? That is subcomplex. For any n simplex f of delta n prime, I'll denote alpha f. I am going to define various numbers here now. Alpha f is the number of n minus 1 faces mapped onto L. Okay, you have fixed one face, n minus delta n minus 1 is one of the faces, right? There are in delta n is n plus 1 n minus 1 phases. So I have taken L to be delta n minus. Look at all for any n simplex f inside delta n, look at alpha f denote the number of n minus 1 phases which are mapped on to L. Put S1 equal to sum of all these alpha f's where f range is over all the phases of delta n prime. Okay. Next, that is S1. S2 denote the number of n simplexes of delta n prime, this time n simplexes, which are mapped on to delta n by phi. Then last, there is another one, S3, the number of n minus 1 simplexes of the boundary of delta n prime mapped on to L, again by phi. So three different things we are counting. The claim is that all these three are equal if you count mod 2. If any one of them is odd, other two are also odd. If any one of them is even, all the other two are also even. That is the meaning of S1 is congruent to S2, congruent to S3 mod 2. Okay. So let us prove this one. Then Sperner lemma will follow very easy. First, note that fix one simplex f. See, what is this? F is n minus 1 simplex. Okay. Alpha f will be either 0, nothing is mapped on to L, or it could be 1, one of the simplex goes to f, or it could be two of them. Nothing more than that. Okay. Because you see, what is f? F is an n simplex. Okay, so let us take, for example, one simplex. Then I am taking n minus 1 simplex, a single point. So these two points, none of them may go to that point. Only one of them may go to that point, or both of them may go to point. That's very easy. Now you take a triangle, for example, and take a simplex, one simplex. So there are three edges there. None of them may go there. Only one of them may go there. If two of them go there, the third one will have to go to a single point. That is all. There's no other choice. The same way, if two of the things go to n simplex, to an n minus one simplex, the rest of the other things will have to be going into a smaller set than an n minus 1 set. Therefore, the first thing to observe is that alpha f is either 0, 1 or 2. Okay. What is the meaning of alpha f is 1? That means one n minus 1 phase goes to n minus 1 phase. It's only one. That means the rest of them must have gone to an n simplex. Okay. That means P is restricted to F is a bijection onto the whole of delta n. Okay. Thus, the collection of all n simplexes of F of delta n prime is divided into three groups depending upon alpha F is 0, 1 or 2, A0, A1 and A2. Okay. According to the value of alpha F. It follows that if you work modulo 2, A0 and A2 will not contribute anything. Only the class A1 will contribute 1. Because either this is 2, mod this is 0, right? So that is what we have. So S1, which is sum of all alpha Fs, okay, instead of taking all F, you can take only F inside A1. So each of them will give you one. Sum total is precisely now equal to S2. Because A1 corresponds to those F which are mapped onto fully onto delta N. That is the definition of S2. So we have already proved that S1 is congruent. Here congruent, this is equal, that is equal. So it's equal to S2. Congruence is modulo 2 here. Next, Now, S1 also counts the number of n minus 1 faces of G, okay? Now, one face is G of delta n prime boundary, which are mapped onto L, except that, you see, if you look at all n minus 1 faces, each n minus 1 face will occur twice in a n face, in a n simplex, as boundary of one side and the other side. There are exactly two sides inside a delta n. There is no other choice. So it will be counted twice if and only if it is an interior n minus 1 face. On the boundary, it will be only one. It will count only once. Therefore, cutting down all these entries which are occurring twice leaves us with only those G which are in the boundary of delta n. The boundary of delta n, n minus 1 faces occur as a face of an n simplex only once. Only one simplex. The interior thing will occur exactly in two different places. Two different simplexes. So when you are counting S2, those things won't contribute anything. So this last thing tells you that cutting all these entries, okay, the sum total is actually equal to S2. So S2 congruent to mod S3. Okay. So therefore S1 and S2 and S3 are all congruent to each other. If you still have difficulties, what you have to do is do it for n equal to 1, where it is completely obvious. Okay. You work it out. You have to read it carefully. I have read it in the beginning at least 3 times, and now I have taught it n times. So that's a different thing. So everybody has to work it out on its own. Do it for a single edge. You have to cut it into number of edges, right? Because it's a subdivision you have to take. And then work out what is happening. For S1, S2, S3, understand that. If you still have doubts, do it for a triangle, the next stage. Let's see what happens. Beyond that, yeah, you don't have to do, it's not easy either. Okay, after that you have to, by that time you must be very, very confirmed that this argument works. You know, only logic will remain there after that. No pictures. Okay? So now we can prove the Sperner lemma by induction. Because we have a passage from delta n to delta n minus 1, right? That is the whole idea. So let Cn, n greater than equal to 1, be the statement for Sperner lemma. Accordingly, we shall temporarily denote these numbers S1, S1n, S2n, and S3n, where they are taking place. Okay. And we want to show that S2n is equal to 1 mod 2. That is the Sperner lemma. The middle one, okay? For all n, we have to show. For n equal to 1, this is very easy, okay? Namely, S3 is 1. Since phi is the identity map, now you have to use that fact. Phi is the identity map on the boundary means, say, 0 goes to 0 and 1 goes to 1. There is no other choice because that is already simplest here. After that, so B delta 1 is boundary, B delta 1 is even E2, okay? So that's just two vertices. Okay. So now, having shown that n equal to 1, this is true, assume the statement for Cn minus 1, n minus 1, and n greater than 2. Okay. Since phi is a simplicial approximation to the identity when restricted to the boundary, each n minus 1 face G prime of G, where G is an n minus 1 face, okay, of the boundary will be mapped into itself because it's identity map. In other words, only sum of the n minus 1 faces L prime are mapped onto L. Okay, therefore it follows that S3 of n is same thing as S2 of n minus 1. But now we have proved that S2 of n minus 1 is already odd. Therefore, S3 of n is odd. The S3 of n is again S2 of n, modulo 2. Okay, I will repeat this part. So what is happening here? Look at this one. Look at n minus 1 faces of L prime. L is one of simplex. Okay. If it is divided into into smaller pieces, okay, there will be n minus 1 faces. Okay. They, because identity map, they could not have gone out of the L. They will have to be inside L. So that is why you can apply induction for this delta n minus 1. Okay. Therefore, you can look at this S2 n minus 1 is already odd, but that is equal to S2 of n. S3 of n for this part. So I am counting S3 of n, but it can be counted by S2 n minus 1. But S2 n minus 1 is odd, so S3 of n is odd. So on the boundary, its identity map is used to get into the induction hypothesis, cutting down the dimension. So Sperner lemma to many results we can apply now. Okay. Our aim is to prove the Brouwer's invariance of domain. Okay. But first we can prove Brouwer's fixed point theorem for general case. We had proved it for n equal to 2. Right? So let us be done with that. For any integer n greater than or equal to 1, these three statements are equivalent. I think I have done it for n equal to 2, but the proof is exactly the same in general case. So I will repeat, what is this? The first statement is Brouwer's fixed point theorem. Every continuous map on the closed unit disk to unit disk has a fixed point. The second statement is the boundary Sn minus 1 of Dn is not a retract of Dn. The third statement is Sn minus 1 cannot be contractible. Yeah. So it might have forgotten, maybe we'll repeat this proof quickly, okay? So how A implies B? A implies B, we are trying to prove, what we are trying to prove, if not B, then it is a not A. Suppose Sn is a retract of Dn, okay? If R is a retraction, then we will get a contradiction to A. So if R is a retraction means what? A continuous map such that on the boundary it is identity map. So take alpha to be the antipodal map. Then inclusion into Dn. So you get a map from Dn to Dn. Take a point on the boundary. It goes to the same point here. Under this, it goes to minus. Under E tight, it goes to again minus, right? Take X here on the boundary. It goes to X itself here. This under alpha, it goes to minus X. Then it again goes to minus X. So X has gone to minus X. What is happening? Any point here, okay, post something, goes to minus X, goes to minus X. So where alpha X is minus of this. So eta is the inclusion. Then F has no fixed point. Contradiction to A. Okay. So if there is a retraction, then there is no fixed point. If you take any point on the inside the boundary, inside in the interior, it has gone already to some point in the boundary. Again, under alpha, it goes to the boundary point. Under eta also, it goes to boundary point. But the original point was in the interior, so those two cannot be equal anyway. The chance was only in the boundary, but the boundary points go, x goes to minus x. So that's all no. So there is no fixed point at all. That's the contradiction. Okay, now let us prove B implies A. The proof is it exactly same as that we wrote for n equal to 2. Okay, so what we have to do? We have to draw a picture. X, fx, draw the line joining x and fx, extend it towards fx, get a point gx. That will be a retraction. So that's what we have done. Okay, now let us prove B and C are equivalent. Okay, we have seen that if x is a contractible, if and only if x is a retract of the cone, this was one of the theorems. Okay, the cone over Sn minus 1 is Dn. So what does B say? The boundary is Sn minus 1, Dn is a cone, the cone is a retract of the x is a retract of its cone, Sn minus 1 is a retract of the cone over that, then what? Then x is contractible. So here is Sn minus 1 is not contractible, Sn minus 1 is not a retract. The same thing as Sn minus 1 is a retract, Sn is contractible, Sn minus 1 is contractible, right? Therefore, since we have proved B is not contractible, Sn minus is not contractible, and conversely. Okay, now how we are going to use this to prove Brouwer 6-point theorem itself? This is our equivalent. We haven't proved any one of them. We don't know whether any one of them is proved. If you prove any one of them, all the three gets proved, right? So for n not equal to m, finally here, to prove that each of the statement is true, we shall prove B. That is, there is no retraction from Dn to Sn minus 1. If there is one, okay, take a simplicial approximation to it. Call that as phi. Okay, apply Sperner lemma. Sperner lemma says that the number of simplices delta n mapped onto the whole delta n is at least one. It's actually odd. But if it's a retraction, the whole Dn is going inside Sn minus 1. Therefore, no n simplex would have been mapped onto n simplex. Okay. On the boundary, no matter how many times you divide, on the boundary, there will be at the most n minus 1 simplexes or smaller. Right? Because to begin with, there are only n minus 1 simplexes and you are going on dividing them, that's all. So there are no n simplexes left. All the m simplexes are inside, they are all going on to the boundary now. The boundary has only n minus 1 simplexes. Nothing comes into the whole of delta n. All right? So Sperner lemma gives you immediately that there is no retraction of the entire disk onto the boundary. Therefore, Brouwer 6-point theorem is also proved. Okay, now we will prove the simpler version of Brouwer's invariance of domain. Many books call this itself is the Brouwer's invariance of domain. What is that? It says that Rn and Rm, n not equal to m, cannot be homeomorphic. Okay, I have stated it next to that. Rn and Rm are not homeomorphic. How do we prove that? Suppose there is homeomorphism, then you know that you can take 1 point compactifications of this. They will be also homeomorphic to each other. What are 1 point compactification of Rn? It is Sn. Rm, it is Sm. N and M are different. Okay? So we have got a homeomorphism between them. In particular, Sn and Sm will be homotopy equivalent. Right? This is the theorem that says for n not equal to m, Sn is not homotopy equivalent to Sm. So that will complete the proof of Prower's invariance of domain, the next theorem. How does this one is proved? Suppose you have a homotopy equivalence from Sn to Sm. We can assume n is less than m by interchanging the n and m. Okay. Yeah. Now, we have already proved that if n is less than m, any map is null homotopic. So this F is null homotopic. By precomposing with homotopy inverse, homotopy inverse is from G to Sn, right? So G from Sm to Sn, if you compose it with F, composing with any F, homotopy, if F is homotopic to G, G composite F will be homotopic to G composite the, sorry, if F is homotopic to constant map, G composite F will be homotopic to G composite constant map, it's a constant map. Right? Therefore, what you get is Sm to Sm, see, Sm to Sn is G, then F, Sn to Sm back, Sm to Sm, okay, G composite F is homotopic, null homotopic is what you get. But G composite F by definition is homotopic to identity map. So we have got Sm to Sm, identity map is null homotopic. But we have seen earlier, any space, if the identity map is null homotopic, then it's contractible. Right? Now, part C of the previous lemma tells you that there are these three equivalent conditions. Sn minus 1, none of the spheres, if n is floating here, this is not fixed for all n. This is not contractible. So I repeat, because of this theorem, what we have proved is two different spheres, spheres of different dimension cannot be homotopy type, same homotopy type. In particular, they cannot be homeomorphic. From that, it follows that the corresponding Rn and Rm cannot be homeomorphic. Okay. So when this was proved, it was a very great result, landmark result. How Brouwer proved it? More or less through his invention of homology. He had different proofs of this also, by the way. It's a proof by some dimension theory and so on, which are much, very, very much more complicated. So nowadays, homology theory gives you the standard proof of this one. So what I have got is, I have got you this one by just simplicial approximation and Sperner lemma. Okay? There is a stronger version. I have told you this is a weaker version. What is that version? That says that if you take an open subset of Rn, non-empty open subset of Rn, suppose it's homeomorphic to another subset of Rn, just a subset, not the whole entire, there is no homeomorphism of the whole space, just a subset. Okay, suppose this subset, for example, A is homeomorphic to an open disk, just then A itself will be open inside Rn. So that is called actually invariance of domain. Remember, domain was the word used for open subsets, open and connected subsets inside analysis. So that is how this came to. So that will be our next task, proving the full version of invariance of domain. So we will take it up next time. Thank you.